afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the latest in our Workplace Spotlight series, Time to Schedule Your Visit, How's Your Health and Welfare Plan Feeling? We're excited all of you could join us today. My name is Karen Rasmussen, and I'll be introducing our speakers and periodically jumping in to review some polls. We'll begin with a few housekeeping items, and then we'll get the presentation started. This is a live streaming event and is being recorded. We'll send you a link to the recording 24 hours after the webinar. To listen to the audio, please plug your headphones into your computer or smart device, or alternatively, make sure your speakers are turned up. While we will not be answering questions until the end of the webcast, time permitting, questions may be submitted anytime during the webcast by entering your question in the Q&A text field and clicking submit. I would also like to encourage you to complete our short survey by clicking on the checklist survey icon at the bottom of the screen. And a PDF of this presentation is available for download, along with the additional resources you may find useful, in the resource list next to the presentation slides. Today's webcast is certified for HRCI, SHRM, and CPE credit. For CPE credit, ADP partners with Wolters Kluwer for our CPE learning program. As a reminder, for those that want CPE credit, you will need to respond to 4 out of the 5 polling questions that we have throughout the session to qualify. And going to the link on the screen lets you manage all your courses and access your certificates. I would encourage you to download the presentation slides in the resource area as well, as we have an additional slide at the end to serve as instructions on how to access your certification. Lastly, before I introduce today's speakers, I just want to review our legal disclaimer. Today's presentation is not legal or tax advice. Before taking any actions on the information contained in this presentation, employers should review this material with their counsel. And keep in mind that what we're discussing today is not the final word on any of these topics. Regulations and legislation change, and employers need to comply with current laws. Also, nothing is intended to be a political opinion. ADP has over 60,000 employees and over 600,000 clients across the political spectrum. Our role is to assist employers with their compliance responsibilities. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speakers, Sushma Tripathi and Virginia Nicewander. Sushma serves as Vice President in ADP's Strategic Advisory Services. She's responsible for workforce management consulting and thought leadership to support ADP clients across all human capital management services. She has over 25 years of experience in leadership, operations, and product management, primarily in health and productivity management, employee benefits administration, and wellness outsourcing. Virginia is senior counsel providing legal and regulatory compliance support to ADP's National Account Services business. She has over 15 years of experience in employee benefits, including health and welfare, retirement plans, HIPAA, and executive compensation. Virginia supports the day-to-day business needs of the benefit services product offerings, as well as National Account Services data security and privacy program. With that, Sushma, I know you and Virginia have a lot to talk about today, so I'll turn the event over to you.
Well, thank you, Karen, and welcome everyone to today's webinar, Time to Schedule Your Visit, How's Your Health and Welfare Plan Feeling? So we have a packed agenda today, and what we'll cover is a broad range of topics highlighting some of the key trends and observations, including how employee benefits are used to attract and retain employees. Now, another key trend is around voluntary benefits, so we will focus on that as well. Next, we will provide you with compliance update with a focus on health reimbursement arrangements and wellness programs. We will also cover government activity and conclude with best practices for you. As I mentioned before, we have a packed agenda today, so let's get started. Now, attracting and retaining a talented, committed workforce is critical for employers. So we are seeing a shift in benefits back from being a burden to an asset. Now, this is because when an employer's benefits programs meet the employee's needs, the employers enjoy a significant competitive advantage, among other things. And we are seeing that employers are trying to map the benefits they offer not only to their current culture, but also to the new culture they are trying to create. They are personalizing benefits for the multi-generational workforce. And in fact, it's not just the multi-generational workforce. Your workforce is actually multidimensional, as you may have employees who may be working full-time, or they might be working part-time, or some might be working variable hours. They may be either working on-site or from a remote location, or they could be working from home. Now, some employees may be away from work on a leave of absence, including on disability, and may not have access to computers and work emails. So as an employer, you need to make sure you communicate with all of your employees appropriately. And remember that each employee has different needs when it comes to health and welfare benefits. So you need to provide simple, digestible pieces of information so that you stand a better chance of making sure that your employees understand what the benefits entail and are empowered to make the best choices for themselves. Now, another trend is to centralize the buying experience, including the use of mobile devices, in addition to the traditional options of using your benefits portal and the web. Now, we are seeing that employers are offering both discretionary and non-discretionary benefits, including voluntary benefits to full-time and their part-time employees. And there's a renewed focus on communication and education to basically raise awareness as well as ensure understanding and appreciation of benefits that are being offered. So in a nutshell, employers are strategically leveraging employee benefits as a recruitment and retention tool.
So Sushma, why don't we do the first polling question? The first question is, does your organization offer voluntary benefits to your employees? We've got four answers here, yes, no, considering adding, unsure. You've got 30 seconds to respond, and the clock starts now.
Thank you so much, Virginia. And I'm just going to sneak in and give my first CPE reminder. For those of you that would like CPE credit, to please make sure you respond to four of the five questions we'll have today to qualify. And I'm going to give you all several more seconds to make sure you have enough time. If for some reason you're not seeing the polling question, you can answer it in the Q&A text field. It's fine. Okay, Sushma, you should be seeing the results on the screen.
Actually, it's not showing on the screen, so sorry. Do you mind?
No, absolutely. Yeah, I'll read them out for you. So we have almost 90%, 89.8, are saying yes, they do offer voluntary benefits. Only 5% are saying no, and then the remaining 3.4% are considering adding them.
Well, thank you, Karen. So, this is a good lead to our next section because, yes is a good answer, right? And it's a key trend that people are looking at voluntary benefits, and these voluntary benefits are actually going mainstream. So let's take a look at voluntary benefits and really, think about what do we mean when we say voluntary plans? Well, traditionally, voluntary plans are generally insurance coverages offered to employees on a voluntary basis, with employees paying the whole premium. And, good examples that most people are familiar with are your supplemental benefits, such as your supplemental short-term disability or long-term disability or life insurance programs, etc. Or voluntary plans may involve individual policies issued to employees directly through insurance companies. For example, it could be something like hospital indemnity, cancer, or other disease-specific coverage. Now, some employers are offering employee assistance program for life events or even dealing with daily tasks. For example, parenting, elder care, finding trustworthy pet care, emotional health, etc. So with that in mind, let's take a look at some of the key trends and observations. Well, voluntary benefits have gone mainstream in the last few years, and many employees may say that they are more likely to stay with their current employer primarily due to the voluntary benefits package offered. Now, this includes both insured voluntary benefits products and the non-insured voluntary benefits products. Now, we've established that voluntary benefits are you know, used to attract and retain employees, and that's why most of you checked yes. And it's important to note that big data and analytics is used to target and personalize preferences and benefits. Now, this is beyond demographics. For example, you have age, gender, income, and education levels. Now, other considerations these days include things like lifestyle, housing patterns, and more. And then there's financial wellness. You know, that is actually gaining momentum. There are new products and services around education, counseling, and loans that are gaining importance. And then wellness programs, you know, those actually continue to rank high as well. Whether you're running a step challenge, a healthy eating campaign, or a mindfulness series, there are apps and wearable devices that are helping maintain health as well as creating employee engagement. Lastly, in addition to benefits portals and enrollment platforms, employers are providing access to voluntary benefits through mobile. And there's actually more to come. Now, as you can see, voluntary benefits are important, but can often fall through the cracks, particularly during open enrollment. So here are some best practices for you. From the previous discussion, you can see that employers have choices. They can offer a whole array of voluntary benefits. Therefore, you have to be strategic and thoughtful about what you offer. Ensure that the products you have selected provide value to your employees and can be tailored to your employees' needs. A well-tailored program that reflects the makeup of the workforce can be more effective and result in higher participation. Another thing to keep in mind is to make sure you provide easy access and integrate these voluntary programs with your core benefit offering. Also, allow for personal preferences and customization. Provide decision support tools, and most importantly, communicate and educate employees. Now, I truly want to stress the importance of communication and education. As we have seen, employers who offer long-term disability programs as a part of voluntary benefit package to certain employees, and because of lack of clear communication and education, your 26-year-old new employee may not have understood the importance of purchasing that coverage and not elected those benefits. And unfortunately, if that employee is in a freak accident, it could be detrimental for them. Now, they will not only lose their pay, but if they are unable to return to work within a reasonable time frame, it may impact their employment status, resulting in a loss of health insurance when they need it the most. And as we all know, COBRA coverage can be expensive, therefore unaffordable, especially if your employee or the terminated employee is not receiving any pay. So always remember that the employee communication and education is key. Now, most employers who have a calendar year plan are in annual enrollment season right now, so I encourage you to think about how you are communicating and educating your employees, and is it enough? And finally, although voluntary benefits are the wave of the future, employees continue to expect more traditional benefits. And as a result, employers must continue to keep their eye on the ball when it comes to compliance around the traditional offering. So this concludes the discussion on voluntary benefits. And our next section is compliance update. But before we go there, we have our second polling question for you. And the question is your organization considering offering one of the new HRA options? So you have four choices, and they are: I'm not sure, what are you talking about, for those who are not sure, or still figuring out what the regulations say, or considering for next plan year, or we are already putting it in place. Now, just like before, you have 30 seconds to respond, and the clock starts now.
Thank you so much, Sushma. And I'm going to give my second CPA reminder for those of you that would like credit, CPE credit, specifically, to please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. And again, if for some reason you're not seeing the polling question in the slide area, you can definitely answer in the Q&A text field. I'll give you all a few more seconds. Okay, Sushma, you should be seeing the results on the screen, but if not, just let me know and I'll read them out for you.
Okay, so it seems like we have, most people are still figuring it out, which makes sense. And, you know, after that, we have around 33%. I'm not sure, you know, as to what you're talking about. And actually, that's a great segue. So, Virginia, can you get us started on the health reimbursement arrangements, also known as HRA, by providing our audience with a brief background on that?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you, Sushma, and welcome, everyone. So let's talk a little bit about these new health reimbursement arrangements. Prior to the enactment of the Affordable Care Act, employers had the option of providing tax-favorable benefits to employees and retirees through health reimbursement arrangements, which are similar to flexible spending accounts and/or health savings accounts. Employers would fully fund the arrangement with no contribution from the employee. Although the ACA did not specifically reference HRAs, many of the provisions of the ACA made it extremely difficult for an employer-funded HRA to meet the requirements of the ACA. Some examples include the annual and lifetime limits and the requirements to offer preventative care. Eventually, agency guidance was issued expressly stating that HRAs could not reimburse for individual medical policies and that so-called standalone HRAs would not meet the ACA requirements. After the guidance was issued, employers were limited to offer four types of health reimbursement accounts: one limited to retirees only, another for limited purposes, which could only reimburse for dental and vision, an integrated HRA, which needed to be coupled with traditional group health plan, and a qualified small employer HRA. Fast forward to October 2017 and the issuance of the Executive Order 13813, requesting that the relevant agencies evaluate whether it would be possible for HRAs to be available as an offering to meet the requirements of the ACA. In October of 2018, the three agencies responsible for enforcing the ACA issued joint proposed regulations setting forth two new health reimbursement arrangements. The regulations remained open for public comment until the end of December 2018. The final regulations were issued on June 20, 2019 and become effective January 1, 2020. The final regulations established two new health reimbursement arrangements available to employers of any size. The two new arrangements are called individual coverage health reimbursement arrangements, often referred to or seen as ICHRAs, and an accepted benefit HRA. The regulations identify a number of requirements and address several compliance issues that previously made so-called standalone HRAs problematic. The final regulations largely adopted the proposed requirements.
So, Virginia, what is the difference between the two new HRAs?
It's a great question. Let's start by defining each of them. The ICHRA is intended to allow employers to offer tax-preferred dollars to an eligible individual to purchase individual coverage on the marketplace. As I noted earlier, this had been seen as previously unacceptable under the ACA guidance prior to the executive order. Generally speaking, the combined HRA and individual coverage are intended to allow the employer to meet the requirements under ACA that previously were problematic without offering traditional group health coverage to these employees. We'll walk through the specific rules and limitations related to the ICHRA in just a moment. On the other side is the accepted benefit HRA, which allows for the employer to offer a reimbursement arrangement that is in addition to traditional group health plan coverage. Reimbursement can be for those things such as copays, deductibles, or non-covered expenses. There are certain limitations on this type of HRA, which we will review later. An accepted benefit HRA, however, cannot be used to reimburse an individual for individual coverage. Keep in mind that both options are considered subject to additional rules similar to traditional group health plans and other accepted benefit plans, such as COBRA. The amount contributed is determined. So let's first talk about the requirements under the ICHRA. The amount contributed is determined by the employer. There is no regulatory minimum or maximum established by the regulations. The regulations do not mandate when the funds must be made available. This allows an employer flexibility to make the funds available at the beginning of the year or on a pro rata basis throughout the year. Note that for purposes of ACA, if the ICHRA is considered affordable, the individual would not be eligible for a premium tax credit. The IRS recently issued guidance on this topic, which we will discuss in just a bit. An individual enrolled in the ICHRA can be reimbursed for medical care expenses, including the premiums for individual coverage. However, there are some limitations. The ICHRA cannot reimburse an individual for short-term limited duration health insurance or any other accepted benefits. An employer may define eligibility in a number of ways. The final regulations adopt the various classes of employees that can be grouped together for purposes of eligibility. We've listed out the various groups here on the slide for your information. Keep in mind that an employer may elect to combine several groups together to create a class of employees. In addition, an employer has the ability to distinguish between newly hired and existing employees, provided that the minimum sizes for classes of eligible employees are met.
So, Virginia, can an employer have a class of one employee, or are there rules around that?
So, no, an employer can't have a class of one, and there are certain rules around it. There are many factors in determining whether a minimum class size is required, though. The minimum class requirements apply when an employer offers a traditional group health plan to one or more classes of employees and ICHRA to one or more other classes of employees. The regulations also take into account the types of classes offered the ICHRA, focusing in on full-time, part-time, salaried, non-salaried, and employees in the same rating area. Generally speaking, if the minimum size requirements apply, we'll have different tiers for the employers. So if the employer has fewer than 100 employees, each class must have at least 10 employees. If the employer has between 100 and 200 employees, the required class size is 10% of total employees, rounded down to the next whole number. And for larger employers with 200 or more employees, they must have 20 employees in the class. The final regulations require that the participant actually enroll or be enrolled in individual coverage in order to receive benefits under the HRA. The employee is required to substantiate enrollment in individual coverage at least annually. This can be done, for example, as part of the annual enrollment election. The rules include a model attestation that can be used for this purpose. At the time of reimbursement, the employee must also substantiate coverage under an individual plan leveraging a model attestation, or the employee can provide other documentation to show enrollment. For those classes offered the ICHRA, the employer cannot also offer a traditional or other group health plan coverage. The ICHRA must be the only option available to that class of employees. In addition, there are administrative requirements that must be maintained throughout the participation in the ICHRA, such as allowing the individual to opt out of future reimbursements at least annually and at termination, as well as allowing terminated employees to forfeit any available amounts.
So, Virginia, did the regulations include a model notice for employers to use in connection with the ICHRAs?
Yes, it did, especially given the number of requirements that are in the final regulations around the notice. So as part of the final regulations, the departments issued a model notice that can be provided to employees, obviously modified as necessary for the plan design, that describes the impacts of electing, including on the premium tax credit. It explains what individual coverages are acceptable, the individual's right to opt out at least annually, and referring the individual to available resources related to individual coverage. Finally, the final regulations give an employer flexibility to allow for an employee to make additional pre-tax elections to a cafeteria plan to pay for the remainder of individual coverage. Concerns have been raised regarding an employer inadvertently making the individual coverage subject to ERISA. In order to address this concern, FAQs are available through the IRS and provide additional information on that point. Generally speaking, the notice that must be provided notes that individual coverage is specifically not subject to ERISA. And an employer should also make sure not to endorse any specific individual coverage and allow the individual to make their own personal selection.
So, Virginia, I would imagine that employers would be, you know, curious as to how the offering of an ICHRA might affect the ACA employer mandate and non-discrimination rules. As we all know, an applicable large employer is subject to the shared responsibility mandate under certain circumstances. Also, you know, given the various classes that are available, it would seem that an employer could potentially run into non-discrimination issues if the offering isn't set up appropriately. So can you tell us a little bit more about any guidance that might be helpful to our audience?
Of course, Shushma. So on September 30th, 2019, the IRS issued proposed regulations addressing both the affordability requirements and the non-discrimination rules applicable to the new ICHRAs. First, the proposed regulations clarify and confirm that an ICHRA is an eligible employer-sponsored plan for purposes of ACA, including the employer shared responsibility mandate. In addition, such ICHRAs are deemed to provide minimum value due to the fact that the individual insurance market rules regulate the offering in such a way to meet the minimum value rules for group health plans. Second, if the ICHRA is affordable as determined by using a safe harbor, and even if an individual receives a premium tax credit, the employer will not be subject to the B penalty under the ACA employer mandate. The proposed regulations provide two basic safe harbors for purposes of affordability. The first is a location safe harbor. Under this safe harbor, this allows for the employer to use the monthly premium for the lowest cost silver plan determined by the individual's residence. However, an employer may use the primary worksite of employment for this purpose, provided that if the worksite changes mid-year, whether it's indefinite or permanent, the new worksite location must be the point of reference not later than the first day of the second month following relocation. If an employee works remotely, then the worksite is determined either by the location the employee reports into, or if no such location, the employee's residence. Given the typical timing of the publication of rates on the ACA exchanges, the proposed regulations offer a second safe harbor method, which is referred to as a look-back month safe harbor. For calendar year plans, this permits the employer to determine affordability in relation to the monthly premium in the ACA exchange for the January of the prior calendar year. For example, for a plan year beginning on January 1, 2020, the employer would look to the January 2019 monthly premium for the lowest cost silver plan. For non-calendar years, the employer must use the monthly premium in the ACA exchange for the January of the current year. For example, if the new plan year starts on April 1, 2020, the employer would look to the January 2020 monthly premium for the lowest cost silver plan. This method accommodates for the fact that the employer rate plan rates and designs are often set well in advance of when the ACA exchanges publish their rates for the upcoming year. Finally, the proposed regulations address the application of the non-discrimination rules to the ICHRAs. The rules under Section 105H prohibit discrimination in favor of highly compensated employees, and plans are prohibited from increasing limits on benefits based upon age. However, the ICHRA regulations permit for increased amounts based upon age, provided that specific requirements are met, meaning the ICHRA can allow for the oldest age band to receive an increased benefit so long as it is no more than three times that provided for the youngest. The proposed regulations clarify that so long as the ICHRA rules are met, Section 105H will not be violated in terms of plan design. However, an employer must also consider whether the operation of the plan results in impermissible discrimination. One way to avoid operational discrimination is to limit reimbursement under the ICHRA to the cost of premiums, which are typically excluded from testing requirements. Let's now turn to talking a little more about the accepted benefit HRA. While the accepted benefit HRA must be offered in conjunction with a group health plan, an individual may waive the group health plan coverage and still participate in the accepted benefit HRA. The maximum amount will be indexed for inflation each year and is currently set at $1,800 for the 2020 tax year. The employee cannot be reimbursed for individual health insurance premiums, group health plan premiums, or Medicare premiums. The individual can be reimbursed for COBRA premiums, however. The reimbursement can be for dental or vision, as well as short-term limited duration insurance.
Well, thank you, Virginia. So let's go to our third polling question. And the question is, have you made any changes to your wellness program given the recent changes in the overall compliance environment? Now, there are three simple choices, and they are yes, or no, or you're considering it. And again, just like before, you have 30 seconds to respond, and the clock starts now.
Thank you so much, Sushma and Virginia, for all this valuable information. And as Sushma said, you have about 10 more seconds to respond. I'd just like to give my CPE reminder for those of you that would like CPE credit to please make sure you do answer the question. Okay, Sushma, you should be seeing the results now.
All right. It seems like most people, almost 64%, said no, and, 21.6% said they're considering it, and the balance said yes. So, Virginia, can you provide our audience with a wellness compliance update?
Certainly, and I'm actually not surprised by that result at all. A lot of employers feel comfortable with their current plan. So let's start with some history on the EEOC regulations. After many years of uncertainty, during which the EEOC lost cases on the ability of the ADA to control wellness programs, the EEOC decided to set out their views in the form of regulations. They issued proposed rules in April 2015. Those proposed rules received harsh criticism given the already intricate framework of wellness plan regulations. The proposed regulations generated over 2,700 public comments. When finalizing the regulations, the EEOC largely ignored the public comments and issued their final regulations in May of 2016, largely following their proposed regulations. Of important note is the fact that the EEOC took the position in the final regulations that the bona fide benefit plan safe harbor in the ADA does not apply to these plans. The bona fide benefit plan safe harbor is a provision in the ADA that exempts from the ADA a so-called bona fide benefit plan as long as the plan is not a subterfuge for discrimination. Because most wellness plans are ERISA group health plans, sponsors reasonably thought that they didn't have to worry about the ADA, given that such wellness plans are bona fide benefit plans. The EEOC, however, went to great lengths to claim that the safe harbor does not apply. So whether or not your wellness program was a group health plan, wellness programs needed to be concerned about the ADA rules. Once the EEOC had justified why it needed to issue its own set of regulations, they went an entirely different route rather than building on the existing HIPAA wellness rule structure. The major focus of the EEOC rulemaking is whether a wellness program is voluntary. Their view, as a bona fide plan safe harbor is not applicable, is that the wellness program must be voluntary to pass muster. So what does that mean? The final regulations prohibited adverse employment action. This meant an employer could not fire or retaliate against an employee for not participating. similar to the HIPAA rules, the employer side of the house cannot know about participation or the results of the wellness program. This particular requirement did not garner too much attention. The final regulations impose additional notice requirements to disclose how the data was to be used and that the results would be kept confidential. This notice is on top of the HIPAA reasonable alternative notice. In addition, the notice must include information similar to information that is required in a HIPAA privacy notice. We'll discuss this a little more in detail. The wellness program must be reasonably designed to promote health. This means an employer may have to prove it relates to managing health care or health care status. The wellness program itself cannot be a gateway plan. This cuts off a common design for a lot of welfare programs where the higher value plan option was only available to those who went through the wellness program. The final regulations also set limits on incentives, whether in cash or products, whether phased as rewards or as a penalty. It's the carrot or the stick really doesn't matter.
So, Virginia, what about confidentiality and notice requirements?
So, as I mentioned earlier, they added additional requirements on top of what already existed in the HIPAA hemisphere. The final regulations established an additional confidentiality framework on top of the HIPAA standard. Where the wellness plan is already a group health plan and already subject to HIPAA privacy rules, the regulations are duplicative. If the wellness plan is designed in a way that it is not a group health plan, the final regulations potentially impose additional requirements. The final regulations also required a new notice describing what information will be collected, how it will be used, and other related requirements. Although the EEOC issued a model notice, the point is that the various existing notice requirements, including those under HIPAA, would likely have covered the requirements added by the EEOC final regulations.
Well, thank you, Virginia. Now, it seems like the EEOC really complicated the landscape. I heard that the AARP challenged the final regulations, so can you tell us a little bit more about that?
You're right. The EEOC did complicate the landscape. And so, as a result, AARP filed a lawsuit seeking to hold that the regulations were invalid. The AARP contended that a 30% incentive or penalty rendered an employee's disclosure of ADA and GINA-protected information involuntary, and that employees who could not afford to pay such amounts would effectively be forced to provide the information. The court agreed with the AARP and instructed the EEOC to issue new regulations justifying the incentive limits. The EEOC originally estimated that it would take until 2021 before new regulations could be offered. Eventually, the EEOC amended the final regulations to eliminate the section related to incentives.
So, Virginia, practically speaking, what does this mean for employers?
Well, now that we are under the purported new regime minus the incentive limitations, employers should continue to evaluate on an ongoing basis their wellness plans to conform to the HIPAA, ADA, and GINA rules as appropriate. Here's a simple chart that really spells out what's in and what's out. So there's the added ADA notice. There's a requirement for GINA authorization, which means if you have a spouse or a dependent participating in your wellness program and completing, for example, a health assessment or going through some sort of biometric exam, they must actually sign off and authorize the sharing of that information, and you can't use the wellness program as a gateway plan. What's out are the 30% limitation for incentives related to medical exams or inquiries, and the same limitation relating to genetic information.
Well, thank you, Virginia. Now, our next section is on government activity. So, Virginia, what are we seeing in terms of recent agency enforcement in the employee plan space?
Hi, Sushma. Are you hearing Virginia at this point?
I'm on.
Oops, I'm sorry about that. Phone issues. I'm sorry. Let me start again. So we're shifting gears just a little bit to talk about bigger picture enforcement activity, not necessarily related to the two topics we just talked about. I do want to focus on two specific agencies that have enforcement authority in the benefits space, the Department of Labor and the Department of Health and Human Services. So let's first talk about the Department of Labor. Each year, the Employee Benefits Security Administration, which is a division of the Department of Labor, issues a fact sheet summarizing their enforcement activity for the previous fiscal year. According to the most recent fact sheet available for the 2018 fiscal year, EBSA recovered $1.6 billion in benefits. They were able to close 1,329 civil investigations. 860 of those resulted in recoveries on behalf of plans and plan participants. EBSA received over 170,000 informal inquiries, and of those informal inquiries, they were able to recover $443.2 million in benefit recoveries. We continue to see compliance with the Mental Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act as a key point of enforcement for the EBSA. And in order to share information with the public, EBSA did also share a fact sheet on mental health parity for the 2017 fiscal year. What they shared was that as part of their enforcement activities, they investigated and closed 347 related health investigations. 187 of those were actually subject to mental health parity, meaning they had to evaluate compliance with that law. As part of those investigations, they issued 92 citations for violations of these requirements. This information shows continued focus on employer plans, including health and welfare plans. I want to also now highlight for you two recent DOL enforcement actions. In SmartCore LLC, plan benefits were not being administered due to a failure to forward employee contributions to the claims administrator. In addition to restitution, the fiduciaries of the plan are prohibited from serving in a fiduciary capacity for another plan. The enforcement highlights the need to ensure funds designed for plan funding need to be segregated and applied for those purposes. In addition, the enforcement shows the DOL's willingness to bar individuals from serving in any capacity with respect to an employee benefits plan. The second case I wanted to focus on is Doral Juvenile Group, Inc. In this case, the DOL focused on the tobacco surcharge. The settlement recovers premiums impermissibly charged by requiring a surcharge for tobacco use without the availability of a reasonable alternative or waiver of the requirement. In addition to the restitution, the company was required to modify their plan to meet the requirements and to provide a reasonable alternative. This enforcement action highlights the fact that the DOL is looking into both the design and operation of employee benefit plans. Ensuring your documents comply with the legal compliance requirements and operating in accordance with these documents is key. Let's turn now to the Office for Civil Rights under the Department of Health and Human Services. OCR is responsible for enforcing the HIPAA privacy and security rules that apply to covered entities, including some group health plans, as well as business associates. Over the last several years, OCR has taken a more active position in auditing and investigating covered entities and business associates as mandated by the HITECH Act. OCR investigates in response to complaints, reports of HIPAA security breaches, and of its own accord. In 2008, OCR dealt with over 25,000 complaints. OCR initiated reviews in 483 cases and was able to settle 10 matters and obtain one judgment. As part of those matters, OCR collected $28.7 million in fines. I also wanted to highlight one enforcement action out of the OCR that might be relevant in the benefit space. One case worth noting is Bayfront Health, St. Petersburg. In this case, the hospital failed to provide a mother with timely access to the records of her unborn child. As you may recall, HIPAA provides the right for an individual to access their PHI, and as it relates to dependent, the parents may access the dependent's PHI upon request. The regulation set forth required timelines for providing this information. In this case, the hospital did not meet those requirements. While this was one of the first OCR cases focused on the right of access, this enforcement action highlights the fact that OCR is not going to overlook an individual's right under HIPAA and will take necessary enforcement action to support such rights.
Well, thank you, Virginia. So let's go to our third polling question. And the question is, you know, how prepared do you feel for annual enrollment, right? You have four choices, and they are very prepared or somewhat prepared, not prepared, and if you're unsure, please check unsure. Again, just like before, you have 30 seconds to respond, and the clock starts now.
Thank you so much, Sushma. I'm going to give my usual CPE reminder. For those of you that would like CPE credit, please make sure you respond to the question to qualify. And you can use the Q&A text field if the polling is giving you some grief. Give you all a few more seconds. Okay, Sushma, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Well, it looks like most people are either somewhat prepared or very prepared, which is good. And with that said, let's review some of the best. Employer image and brand are critical to effective recruiting and retention. Also, employee benefits are often tied closely to your brand image. But, you know, when you think about it, employee perception of benefits are highly subjective. There can be low correlation between perceived value of benefits and actual cost, and there's a high correlation between communications practices and perceived value of benefits. So what does this really mean? Well, it means that you need to focus on and understand your workforce profile, your benefits profile, and your administrative practices. Now, your workforce profile can include things like demographics and locations, your employees' attitudes and preferences, your workforce management strategy, your corporate strategy, and other industry considerations. Now, it's also important to understand your benefit strategy. You know, what are your goals and objectives? What is your philosophy around work, family, and flex time, as well as leave of absence? Are you offering what's required by the law or more than what is mandated? Is there a welfare or employee well-being component to your offering? For example, a base LTD or long-term disability plan for all employees with a buy-up option or paid family leave beyond what's required by state and local law. Now, you also have to consider your administrative practices. Is your benefits administration centralized or decentralized? How are your policies and prohibitions related to hours, timekeeping, and pay, as well as leave management recorded and administered? Now, what about benefits enrollment functionality for open enrollment? Also, think about your new hires for the ones who are having a qualified life event and the ones who are becoming newly eligible employees for the first time. How are employees accessing benefits? Do they have self-service tools? Are they using both the web and mobile? Do you have a culture of transparency? Is there a call center or HR representative available to help employees with questions? Is this creating empowerment and helping with employee engagement? As you can see, this is not easy, and there's a lot to consider. So with that said, let's go to another polling question, and this is our final question. The question is, do you use a checklist to plan your annual enrollment? And you have three simple choices. They are yes, no, or you're considering it. And again, just like before, you have 30 seconds to respond, and the clock starts now.
Thank you so much, Sushma, and I will be giving my final CPE reminder. For those of you that would like CPE credit, please make sure you respond to four of the five questions we had today to qualify. So this will be your last chance. Give you all just a few more seconds. Okay, Sushma, you should be seeing the results on the screen now.
Okay, it looks like 62% of our audience says yes. and about 24% says no, and 13.7 considering it. So let's talk a little bit about that and go to our next section. And, you know, as most plan function on a calendar year basis, right? Many of you are probably going through or about to go through a busy annual enrollment season, and you're probably worried about things like, you know, your year-end files, issuing employee ID cards, accurate payroll deductions in the first pay of 2020, et cetera. So here's a checklist of the major items you may want to consider as you finish out this year and also as you plan for your next annual enrollment. Now, of course, these are not all-inclusive, but should serve as a handy tool for you. So keep in mind that you will want to take into consideration the changes in the law that have been made and consider plans and operational compliance accordingly, basically reviewing your people, process, and technology that you're using. Now, one of the best practices is to check your plan document for any necessary updates, including things like eligibility, plan benefits, new vendors, name changes, etc., and make sure these changes are reflected in your summary plan description and your summary of benefits and coverage. And don't forget to update the knowledge base that your call center representatives are using. Also, make sure you update your carrier and rate information with any third-party administrator or vendor that you're using for both annual enrollment as well as for COBRA administration. In addition to that, make sure your stakeholders, including your HR, payroll, and benefits professionals, are up to date on the latest plan changes and that the appropriate adjustments have been made to systems and data transfer protocols. Most importantly, remember to clearly communicate your policies and benefits to all your employees. The bottom line is that employees should understand how the changes will affect them both during open enrollment as well as at the start of the new plan year. Now, this will help minimize questions at the beginning of the year. So let's switch gears and look at benefits changes to date for 2020. Well, here we have a list of summary of changes to contribution limits for 2020. And as you can see, the middle column has all of the updates for 2020. Now, a few items are TBD or to be determined as we are still waiting for updates. Now, last year we received these updates for these types of changes around mid-November. So stay tuned as there's more to come. Now, the changes we are aware of are HSA contribution limit, including both the employer and the employee portion, as well as the high deductible health plan or HDHP minimum deductibles. Now, both of these went up by $50 for self only and $100 for family. And then HSA catch-up contributions for age 55 or older, they stayed the same at $1,000. And the HDHP minimum, maximum out-of-pocket amounts, including the deductibles, co-payments, and other amounts, but not premiums, was $6,750 for self-only and $13,500 for family in 2019. It went up to $6,900 for self-only and up to $13,800 for family. So let's take a look at some more of these changes. Now here, you're looking at summary of changes to the pension contribution limits. Now we don't have the 2020 updates yet, and we want you to know that last year we received these updates around the beginning of November. So again, that's coming up, so stay tuned for this one as well. Now here, you're looking at the employee benefits plan penalties. Now the DOL typically publishes new amounts at the beginning of the calendar year, effective prospectively. So stay tuned for this update as well. Well, you know, we've covered a lot of material today. So in closing, here are some next steps for you. Make sure that you evaluate your programs in light of current trends. Make sure that they are competitive and mitigate compliance risks. If there's a need for change, determine the steps to start. And depending on what you decide to do, you may need funding and approval from your leadership, as well as your finance department. You may need to go through an RFP process. You can take, The RFP process can actually take some time, so remember to start early. Now, make sure you establish your program short-term as well as long-term goals. For example, what changes would you like to make immediately, and what can be delayed or deferred? Also, think about who will be responsible for these programs and how would they be administered, how much time, money, and resources will be required. And finally, stay tuned for regulatory updates as compliance is critical. So in closing, we'd like to say that benefits represents a large portion of an employee's total compensation. So communicate with your employees throughout the year, not just during open enrollment. The most effective communications plan include consistent and ongoing communications and employee education. And with that, I will pass it back to Karen.
Thank you so much, Sushma and Virginia, for all that valuable information. The timing is perfect because everyone really needs it right now, that's for sure. So based on timing, this does conclude our event for today. Your HRCI and SHRM credit information will be included in the thank you for attending email that we send out 24 hours after the event today. And if you requested CPE credit when you registered, you should be able to access your CPE credit using the instructions in the presentation within 24 to 48 hours. To receive ongoing communications from ADP on regulatory and legislative guidelines and deadlines, please subscribe to our Eye on Washington email alerts by visiting the link shown on the screen or indicate you'd like to opt in on the event survey. Also, you can register for additional Workplace Spotlight webinars, such as our Strategies for Surviving Year-End Reporting webinar we are having next Thursday on October 31st using the link shown on the screen. So on behalf of Sushma, Virginia, myself, and the entire team at ADP, we thank you for joining us today and look forward to having you join us for future Workplace Spotlight events. Thank you and have a great rest of your day.